With me tonight, the host of News & Views, Joel Heitkamp. Joel, great to have you back
here. Good to be here.
I want to talk about the overall session. I went in from January going to the session thinking, man, this is a chance for North Dakota to really separate itself, be a model for the rest of the states of America, thinking, I'm going to be high-fiving these guys in the session. I'm not doing that right now. I want to get your thoughts. When we went into this session, what was the number one priority, the number one goal you thought these guys should focus on, and have they done that?
Well, they could have focused on infrastructure. They could have focused on needs like property tax relief and other things, but they never let those take front and center. And the reason they didn't was no one set the agenda. It was Jack Dalrymple's first real powerful legislative session that he as governor could go to and really exert some leadership, saying, this is my agenda, this is what I want. He didn't. He floated a budget out there and he walked away, and the only time they saw him in the chamber was really on the pro-life bills. I mean, that was his primary focus, and then on the Fargo diversion, he showed up on some of that. You know, when you look to leaders this session, there weren't any. I mean, there weren't any. Nobody sticks out and you look at and say, that person rose to the top. And they rose to the top because they provided that even-keeled leadership that made people perceive them to be the one. Tony Grinberg tried to. He lost. Al Carlson tried to. It got away from him. I mean, I really don't know. And that isn't necessarily a criticism as much as it's a leadership style. I mean, I don't walk away from this session saying, that person was John Dorsal. There's no John Dorsal in this session.
I want to share with you, because we asked that earlier in the week, hey, what going to the session, what did you want as citizens of North Dakota? What did you think the priority should be? I want to share this with you. This is what came out. Obviously, tax relief, the number one thing. I want to go through a couple of these with you, but tell me about your grade for them. If you were going to look at their tax relief plan, how would you grade it?
First off, if you're going to look at tax relief, they were too afraid to even look at a sales tax relief for clothing when we're competing on the border against people who give that away. So if you're afraid to even look at that, how can you talk about tax relief? Just because George Sinner Jr. offered it, they were afraid to talk about it because he had a D behind his name. But until you get your hands around assessments, you won't get your hands around property taxes. And of course, now they're really afraid of that because now the bundle's right at their doorstep and it's on fire already.
Does a form of Measure 2 come back in some way, shape, or form in 2014?
No doubt, no doubt. Charlene Nelson and her group are already sharpening the knives. They've already got the they don't care if you tell them you can't pay the volunteers. They'll be at the state fair.
So let me ask you this. What would you say as you look at the session, what has been the top priority in your opinion?
Well, obviously they wanted to pick a fight with the government on Roe v. Wade. I mean, that is the big, they didn't just have one pro-life, pro-choice bill. They had five or six. I mean, that was, it never should have got to there. Regardless of how you feel about the position, one bill would have made the point, maybe two, but it just kept going on and on until it became the story of the session. Again, going back to the lack of leadership. You know, bring them into a room, say, look, we know you're going to try to use state funds to make an argument. You have that right as a legislator, but why do you need to have five, six of these bills in? And for them to say, well, everybody gets the right to do that, no, it hasn't been that way.
Well, the thing is, I think if you look at it and you go, you know what, even if that wasn't the main driver of the session, that's all the media was talking about.
Exactly.
So that was the soundbite. And I want to share something with you again, because as we bring this up, do you see social issues on here at all? Do you see pro-life?
No.
Are these guys tone deaf?
Yeah, well, certainly they allowed the far right fringe of their group to become the leaders. No, let me throw this at you.
I can't hear you there, yeah. Sonny. What was that?
Yeah, exactly.
That's my best legislator impersonation right there. Huh? What?
But let me throw this at you, okay? You'd have to argue that Betty Grandy and Margaret City, two people I disagreed with on certain things, did provide leadership. They did. They knew what they wanted to do this session. They wanted to take everything far right. They didn't care about this. They had their own personal agenda, and they drove the bus. And the rest of the legislators gave them the key to the bus on the majority
so
side.
So is that on Al Carlson? Or?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That falls directly on Al Carlson. And it also falls on Governor Dalrymple, because I will tell you this. If you're in the majority party and your governor is from that same party, he had the opportunity to bring them into his office and say, this ends. We need turning lanes. We need daycare. We need housing in Williston. None of this apparently matters to you. We're done working on this. We're going forward on this.
Let me share one last thing. We can bring this up again. You notice number three. We may get to number two, but pre-K, I don't think that sucked any air out of the room as far as the media is concerned whatsoever. So, again, why are these guys so tone deaf when this is one of the most pervasive problems in the state? I talked to people at United Way at Cass Clay. They said right now, Chris, in the area from 0 to 12, over 29,000 kids that need some sort of program, there's room for 10 to 15,000. And these guys aren't doing anything.
Well, and look at the community we're sitting in right now. We just got the numbers out today on how many people are receiving food assistance in Fargo. Everybody thinks it's grand economic times. We've got to deal with some of these issues internally in our state as we get to be bigger metro areas. But they didn't want to focus on that. They didn't want to focus on that. They wanted to focus on...
Because this is what the people want.
No, no. I agree with you on that. Don't get me wrong. Your impression was spot on. They weren't hearing. But that isn't what the personal agenda was of the people that did show adequate leadership to control the agenda. Imagine the scenario like this. Betty Grandy comes to you and says, I'm taking over the session. I'm going to turn this session into the pro-life session, okay? You're John Dorso. You say, that's fine, Betty. By the way, your new parking spot's in Mandan. You walk to the Capitol every day. By the way, every one of these junkets that you go on that the state pays for, no more. I'm the leader. You don't get that. Al Carlson didn't exercise either one of those things.
But to Betty Grandy's defense, she is as pro-life as they come.
Right.
I don't think she would care if she had to park in Mandan.
I don't blame Betty Grandy. What I blame is the leadership that allowed her to hijack the legislative session. She won. She won. She's about to spend millions of North Dakota dollars on something that won't win.
That's yet to be seen.
And she'll get... Well, right. But understand this. She pushed an agenda and she won. And she ended up being the story of the session.
Speaking of spending potentially millions of dollars, we did spend millions of dollars in the city of Fargo to fight this big, huge flood that did come.
Did you hear the sirens today with the sandbags?
I heard you on your show earlier today. You had a great point. Do you feel that this was politicized because of the session to make sure they got the diversion amendments out and the money they need?
I think that they definitely understood the timing of the flood wasn't going to hurt the passing of what they needed. That being said, that sounds
like
a...
Are you already running for office?
But let me say this. Where they made the mistake in the city of Fargo, they themselves, and they can't blame the National Weather Service for this, was you could see it when they were still doing it and they still never pulled the reins in. They were going through people's yards, using volunteers to put up sandbags that were never going to get touched by water, all under the auspice of it's better safe than sorry. And they didn't need to get to the 40-41 levels when everyone saw it. We didn't need the trucks. We didn't need the sirens.
But then on
we
the
could have
side,
saved money.
You know what happened in Grand Forks. You saw what happened in Illinois this year where the National Weather Service didn't do an accurate job. And so there is this balance.
But Chris, back in 09, when this city needed to raise up quickly 2 feet, remember that? We were sitting there. The flood was going to come in at close to 41. We wanted to be at 43. It didn't take us long. And it wouldn't have took us long if we would have had to react that way again. They didn't trust the volunteers, I don't think, as much as they should have. And in the end, they ended up wrecking yards they didn't need to.
What?
Yeah.
I mean, please, legislators, hear us. I know it's the end, but come on, stay with us. Coming up live from Bismarck at the state capitol, great reporter here at Valley News Live, Brandon Clark. We're going to find out from him what are these guys saying is their number one accomplishment so far this session. He's got a great piece coming up at 10 o'clock tonight as well. As always, join our conversation. Let us know your thoughts. Were these guys tone deaf or not? Go to the website 630 PO.